Hello and welcome to Stage 3, the third and final day of the Citroën Bay Crits. Matthew Keenan and Gracie Elvin with you. Today, Gracie, it's a different course. It's down on Ritchie Boulevard. And this one, as you've said a couple of times already, whether it's at the start or it's at the end, it makes everybody just that little bit more nervous.
That's right. It's usually day one in the past. Every time I raced it for nearly a decade, it was always day one. So you'd be super nervous. But I'd say they're still pretty nervous this morning. It's a really tricky course. We call it a hot dog course just because of the shape of it. So some of the corners there can be quite tough. And sometimes we see crashes on this course. We were just speaking about sometimes there's a bit of sand on the course because they're so close to the beach.
And it's only 650 metres. But you get no rest at all because it is so short. There's the tight corners at either end. Which one's worse? They look the same on paper. Which one's worse?
That first corner, the first left-hand corner after the start-finish line is always the scariest. There's actually a drain across it, so it looks probably worse than it is. And even the paint of the arrows can also be tricky. Luckily, it's not wet for them today. Mm. I think they've got a great day for it. Not too hot either, but it's going to be a really exciting race.
Weather conditions are perfect in Geelong. There's not much wind, unlike what we saw yesterday. And it is a cool, calm 18.6 degrees. Yesterday, it was the Ruby Rose Manganon show once again. She was so good. Likewise, her entire team, Bayside Citroën, they took the race on.
They did. They're certainly the dream team this year. They're very hard to beat, but they're not just sitting and waiting for that bunch sprint. They were sending riders up the road throughout the whole race. Matilda Reynolds had a fantastic last-minute attack in that last lap and really set her teammates up perfectly. And we can see Georgia Baker on the front here doing a perfect lead-out for Ruby Rose Manganon.
It was exceptional. Ruby in the yellow jersey behind her Chloe Hosking. Keely Bennett was one of the stars yesterday in the green jersey. She decided to skip the intermediate sprints, aiming for the stage victory, going head-to-head with some of the world's very best. She was second, but back-to-back wins by Ruby Rose Manganon. Almost an unassailable lead. She has to completely miss out on points today and Amanda Spratt win the race. So the odds of Ruby Rose Manganon not winning the series are super, super slim. What about the prospects of Ruby making it three in a row, taking all of them?
Look, I think that's a very high chance today that she's going to walk away with that yellow jersey and get even more points. She's going to be really tough to beat at the finish, especially with such great team support. But I'm looking forward to seeing what that shuffle might be between second and fifth place. They're so close in points. So I think that's going to be also a hotly contested competition today.
Spratt, Hosking, Baker, Mullins. There's nothing between them. Keely Bennett in sixth position. She's made the decision actually not to start today, partly because she knows that the legs are really good, the form is there, and this is a tricky course around Ritchie Boulevard. Doesn't want to take the risk. I completely understand it. She's targeting the national championships, Sturt Street, Ballarat. I think it's a good call.
That is a good call, though. I think there'll be a number of riders sitting out today just resting their legs up for the national championships coming up. Having two good races in the legs is a really great way to sharpen up going into the nationals. And I think Keely Bennett is going to be one that we're going to be looking at Sturt Street.
She's no longer a dark horse. We've unveiled her as a contender. David McKenzie knows all about contenders. He's going to take a look at this course in Geelong.
Day three of three at the Citroën Bay Crits. And what a day it's going to be. What a location. Eastern Beach here. Look at that. Beautiful beaches here. Ritchie Boulevard. It's the hot dog that we've become to love over the years here at the Bay Crits. Stadium feel. Crowds are rolling in. Yesterday, Ruby Rose Manganon, she went two from two. She's got almost an unassailable lead. Mathematically, she can still be beaten. But she's just got to roll around, finish inside the top 10 safely, and she will be crowned the 2023 champion. But in the men, it's a different story. Graham Frizzley, what a victory yesterday. He turned the tables on Brenton Jones. He goes into the lead. He wears the yellow jersey. For Brenton Jones, he needs to win today. Make no mistake, and Frizzley needs to finish outside of the top three for Jones to have a fairy tale ending to what has been a fantastic career. Either way, we are going to see a battle royale right here on Ritchie Boulevard.
Mac has pulled out the calculator. He knows exactly what's happening in both the women's race and the men's race. It is really tight in the men's race. That's to come after the women who make a start. And it is a significantly smaller peloton than we've seen the last few days. So Gracie, quite a few of them taking the same decision that Keely Bennett took. And she finished second yesterday.
That's right. They're not just resting up the legs going into nationals. They're also reducing that risk because this course is known as one of the more dangerous courses, so you don't really want to crash either in the week before Nationals. I've done that a couple of times. It certainly doesn't set you up for a very good road race, but I think despite the smaller size of the group today, we're still going to be in for a great race. And I don't think Ruby Rose McGannon is going to ride conservatively and sit back and try and defend that yellow jersey. This is the kind of course you still want to be riding on the offensive, because that's actually a safer way to ride anyway, and it's clear that she's got the form to do so.
Yeah, it is a smaller peloton, but on this circuit, being in 15th position, it can still make for a really tough ride because of that concertina effect as they make their way through the corner at each end. Lizzie Stannard at the front again, the white colours of Bayside Citroën. We've seen a lot of her the past few days.
Yeah, she's had a really good ride so far for this team, riding in that the white colours of the Bayside Citroën team. They're all working very well together as a group who don't usually race together for the rest of the season. So that's something that's also a bit different as part of this series. They're coming together as composite teams, such as the Bayside Citroën team, the Novotel Prestige team. They're riding, you can sometimes see them riding with their own team branded Nicks. But they've come together for this series, and it's cool to see how they can just band together very quickly and be cohesive like that. But Lizzie Stannard has certainly been one of the workhorses for Ruby Rose McGannon so far.
She has sacrificed herself significantly, but it's a good step forward in her career, a chance for her to get noticed by some of the other teams as well. What a place to watch a bike race from. Up on the hill, you can see them the whole way around. It is ideal spectating on this course. Spratty on the right-hand side of the screen, the blue and white colours. She's no spectator. She wants to challenge for a stage victory.
She does. She's actually won on this course before back in 2020. She rode a very aggressive race back then. So I think she has that confidence that why not try and do that again? She isn't known as a sprinter, but she surprised all of us on day one, coming in a very close second in that bunch sprint finish to Ruby Rose McGannon. So I think she's really working on her sprint skills in her training, but also using this Bay Crits series to keep working on her speed in the bunch, but also that speed you need at the end of the race to finish it off.
Here is Ruby Rose McGannon in the yellow colours as the overall series leader, and also coming into this race as the defending champion. So she understands dealing with pressure by winning the first two stages as the defending champion, and she's putting the rest of the peloton under some pressure too. Good way to defend is control this stage from the front. Just behind her in the Novotel Prestige Jayco colours, Valentina Scandalara. She struggled with the heat the first 2 days, Gracie. She'll be loving these conditions.
It did cool off for the stage of day two. I think that was a relief to many riders, not just the European riders that have come over without too much heat conditioning. But we can see some of these gaps forming already pretty early. So there's some riders putting a bit of pace on the bunch there. They're not trying to split it, but they're just trying to put pressure on everyone else because of that concertina effect that you mentioned. If you're more than 10 wheels back, you're just having to push out of the corner just a little bit harder than those first few riders. And you can see those gaps forming. All it takes is for one rider to not be as confident in the corner or to not be able to kick out of it as hard. And suddenly you can find yourself on the wrong end of the split, and there hasn't even been an attack for a breakaway.
Often this is the circuit where we see the smallest number of finishes. Because it is so tight, the gaps can open up really quickly. And if you lose a lap, you're out of the race, and it's just 650 metres per lap. It was Georgia Baker who was on the front for the Bayside Citroën team, wearing the Bike Exchange Knicks from last season. It's Jayco Alula, the new sponsors for that team for season 2023. Georgia had a fantastic season last year, winning the Tasmanian Athlete of the Year ahead of cricketer Matt Wade and the swimmer Ariana Titmus, who did so well at the Commonwealth Games. She didn't think she was going to get the title, but she underestimated how good her performances were at the Games.
She was an exceptional rider last year and is an exceptional athlete overall. So she definitely deserved all of those awards that she got at the end of the year through all the various federations. But now we can see her teammate Ruby Rose McGannon in that yellow jersey still putting the pressure on. They're just turning the screws. They're not going super hard yet. They're not attacking super hard, but they're just kind of trying to draw out some of those top riders. You can see Chloe Hosking there in those blue and pink colours of the Rock Salt SRAM team, always staying up in those top five wheels. And in other races, I talk a bit about overriding a race. Some riders are always in the front or putting themselves in the wind a bit too much, and that can really drain you. But this is the course that you could override it, because that's going to be in your favour. You always want to be in those top five wheels if you can, because we can see already that they're starting to split through some of those corners. There hasn't been too many attacks yet, but the bunch is already struggling to be all together, and it's just going to string out more and more.
And it'll do so. When Matilda Reynolds gets onto the front, she sprints out of the corner. She stretches the peloton. Another one of the youngsters to look for is Lucy Stewart. She sits in eighth position in the overall standings as part of the ARA Skip Capital team. And she is a brilliant young track cyclist, just stepping up from the under 19. She's the current Australian under 19 champion. Obviously, she won't be able to defend that in Ballarat. She'll be racing against the elites and the under 23s. This course suits her because she's got bike smarts despite her young years.
That's right. I think she's going to be reveling in this race today. She did so well in her age categories last year across a whole range of different types of racing, but she definitely suits this short, hard, plenty of sprinting in these crit style races. She got to represent Australia at the World Championships in Wollongong last year. And as a junior, you get access to all the elite riders as well. You get to have breakfast and lunch and dinner with them. And they would have gone out on a few recon sessions. So I'm sure she would have picked the brains of Amanda Spratt and some of those other Australian riders. So I think that she's already making the most of every opportunity on and off the bike.
The best sprinter in the race is wearing the yellow jersey and she's going solo. She's showing that she's got a few tricks up her sleeve.
I'm not surprised at all by this move by Ruby Rose McGannon. As I said, it's actually safer on this kind of course to be on the offensive and to be attacking everyone else and not riding conservatively as you might do in a road race if you're wearing a leader's jersey or you're the designated bunch sprinter. She's going, I don't want to be in the mess through all of these corners. I know how fit I am. I can just ride away from you all. And that's exactly what she's doing. So this is a really, it's a smart move actually for Ruby Rose McGannon to defend the jersey like this and stay upright because she has the most control now through all of the corners and the pace that she wants to set.
Brilliant performance by Ruby Rose McGannon. She's won the first two stages. They've been racing for roughly 7 minutes so far. So there are 3-minute sprints after 15 minutes, 30 minutes and 45 minutes. Then at the 50-minute mark, they get 3 laps to go. So the race time-wise will be significantly shorter than what it was yesterday and the day before because this course is so much shorter. Taking up the chase, it is Amanda Spratt. So second in the general classification, chasing first. Great to see the Spirit of Tasmania on board as partners with the Bay Crits in 2023. Significantly, as we look to riders such as Lucy Stewart yesterday, Keely Bennett talking about the future, Spirit of Tasmania have been supporting the junior races at this year's Bay Crits. And before each of the elites, there's been junior races for under 11s, under 13s, under 15s and under 17s. So it's good to see that support coming through for the next generation of Australian cyclists. Ruby still solo. She's into time trial mode and the chase is serious behind. The green jersey today is worn by Danny DeFrancesco. On a count back, it's actually Ruby Rose McGannon who is the leader of the race for the green jersey. That's the battle for the Mitchelton Wines points classification. So Danny DeFrancesco, she is wearing that for today.
You could also see Valentina Scandalara. She's been working hard on the front to make sure Ruby Rose McGannon doesn't get too much of a gap. She's wearing a light blue jersey and representing the Novotel Prestige Jayco team. She's been a winner of this series overall twice and she's won on this particular course once back in 2017. She's a feisty little Italian rider, so this kind of course really suits her, but she is also not just sitting back in the bunch and waiting for the race to happen near the end. She's making sure that she's in that front covering the moves, but also working hard to make sure that Ruby doesn't get away too far.
And likewise, Danny DeFrancesco, the Rock Salt Live Shram team, also towards the front. They're working for Peter Mullins and Chloe Hosking. Both Peter Mullins and Chloe Hosking are on 12 points. Amanda Spratt in second position on 13 points. You win the stage, you get 12 points, 10 points for second place, 8 points for third place, working its way down to 1 point for 10th position. Gracie Elvin, I'm looking forward to seeing what the strategy is from Roxalt. Who do they work for, Chloe or Peter?
I think they would love to be on the overall podium at the end of the day, but the most important thing is still a stage win. So they're going to be still supporting Chloe Hosking, I'd say, in this stage. Chloe has not won this stage, this particular course, not once, but 3 times in the past. So she does know how to win on Ritchie Boulevard. and she's still coming into form. Plus, as we've talked about in the other stages, they're really supporting her not just to win these races, but to try and get a contract this year. She's without a pro contract currently, so these races are even more important than they usually are to Chloe, and I think that they're doing their best to try and set her up to try and win this final stage today.
Ruby has been caught, and her teammate, Matilda Reynolds, is the next to go on the attack. The same strategy we've seen from this team right throughout all three stages. Attack, if it doesn't work, attack again. And if that doesn't work, let Ruby win the sprint. Not a bad strategy. It's working for them.
It is. They've definitely got a good strategy, but they've got the strength to back it up. The important thing with that kind of tactic is you need to have riders in good position. So when a rider is brought back by the bunch, someone can attack almost straight away. And it's a bit like punching. You're just really one-twoing the bunch, softening them up, tenderizing them, because everyone has to decide whether they want to cover moves or not, whether that's going to be the breakaway that sticks or if it'll come back again. But this is a breakaway of four riders that could be dangerous. To me, it looks like Matilda Reynolds there in the white helmet and white jersey for the Bayside Citroën team. Behind her is Valentina Scandalara, the winner of this series twice in the past and winner on this course, and two Rock Salt riders there too. So that's quite dangerous to have two riders from the same team in a group of four.
Four leaders working well together. They've got themselves in a good position, particularly for the other riders that are there, along with Matilda Reynolds. It lets them get themselves in a position where they can see the strongest team actually assist the peloton to slow down. We've got a question here from Pam Lister asking, is the wind a factor? Pam, normally it is on this course, but there's hardly any breeze at all. And the flag's indicating that it might be just a slight tailwind when it comes down to the sprint finish.
That's right. It's actually handy not just for the sponsors to have those flags on the course down there. It's handy for us and the riders to see what direction the wind is. And they're not blowing very hard today, so I do not think the wind is going to be a factor today. But it could blow up. They're still on the coastline, but it is quite sheltered on this home straight because of all of those tents and signage there. They're going to just keep working well together now, and the bunch is going to have to decide how they want to react. We can see Danny DeFrancesco trying to jump across and bridge that gap. She was really strong yesterday and the first day. She's surprising us. She's here just riding for herself, but she is definitely one of the stronger riders in this bunch today. No doubt she will get pretty close, if not get across to this group of four.
A rider in there from ARA Pro Racing Sunshine Coast. Another one in there from Rock Salt, along with the Bayside Citroën team. The strong teams represented at the front, and likewise for Novotel Prestige Jayco with Valentina Scandalara, causing a big reaction from the peloton. And it's the green jersey of Danny DeFrancesco who is trying to close things down as we head towards the first intermediate sprint. Still a few minutes away from getting the first of the intermediate sprints. Looks like Tilly Field in second spot for the Rock Salt Liv Schramm team.
There's another rider there from the ARA Skip Capital team jumping onto the wheel of Danny DeFrancesco, trying to jump across to her teammate. It's hard to tell sometimes the difference between the Rock Salt and the ARA Skip Capital jerseys. They're very similar in colour, but well, good picking, Matt, there to pick out who those riders are so far. But the two working behind looks like they're going to work well together to try and catch up to these front group of four.
Matilda Reynolds leads them through the bottom corner, followed by Scandalara. Tilly Field it is from the Rock Salt team. Here comes the chase from the yellow jersey. Ruby Roseman Gannon being followed by Amanda Spratt. Next in line was Lucy Stewart. So Lucy Stewart knows exactly where she wants to be as she is marking the moves of the other big favourites. Alicia Wells is the rider who was out there for ARA Skip Capital. And the whistle has gone for the intermediate sprint. So the first of the intermediate sprints, Danny DeFrancesco in the green jersey has got herself in a good position to pick up three more points in the race for green. If she can close down that gap to the four leaders, it's going to be close, Gracie.
It is going to be close. She was out of the saddle for quite a long time there, out of that corner, covered by, it looks like, Amanda Spratt and Ruby Roseman Gannon as the bunch swelled to catch up those chasers trying to jump across to this group of four. It looks like they might just hold them off for this intermediate sprint, though.
Scandalara takes a look across the shoulder to assess the situation behind. This is Rachel Wales now for ARA Skip Capital, who's leading the chase behind. Scandalara picking up the points. Alicia Wells perhaps in second position. Tilly Field, Matilda Reynolds will wait for confirmation for the place in significantly equal first, 6 points apiece for both Danny DeFrancesco and Ruby Roseman Gannon in the race for the green jersey. Neither of them getting points in the first of three intermediate sprints in this third and final stage.
This course is just relentless. There's really not that much opportunity to catch a breath or a break or rest the legs. This group of four out in front, they're working quite well together, and the bunch behind is chasing every corner out of every corner. So if you're any further back than maybe fifth or tenth wheel, you're really working hard at the back of this group, as that concertina effect is really making it so much harder. Now we're 15 minutes into this race.
So the intermediate sprint, the points go into Valentina Scandalara first across the line. So she picks up 3 points in the race for the green jersey. Second place went to Alicia Wells from ARA Skip Capital. So 2 points for her, and 1 point for Tilly Field from Rock Salt Liv Schramm. And now the peloton, they've backed off significantly and the gap is starting to grow for the four leaders. And it can grow really quickly on this course. You kick the clutch in for one lap or anything more than that in the peloton, all of a sudden you can find yourself a half a lap behind.
That's right. That gap is already blown out quite a lot already, with the bunch sitting up just a touch there. Looked like they did have a lot of interest in that intermediate sprint. Couldn't quite get there for the points. But I think the Bayside Citroën team are happy enough to back in Matilda Reynolds in this group of four. I'm not sure what the other teams are thinking, though, with their riders represented up in this group. Alicia Wells, riding in the ARA Skip Capital jersey, is not actually in their official team, so she won't be collecting points or going for the overall win for that team. She's riding as an individual in this series. I think the team would still be pretty happy to get her up for a result, though, Matt, don't you think?
I'm confident they'll be very pleased to get her up for a result. It moved from the Novotel Prestige Jayco team. They have Amanda Spratt, who sits in second position in the overall standings. For her to be able to win the series overall, mathematically it is possible, but the odds are really slim. She has to win the stage and have the current yellow jersey, Ruby Roseman Gannon, finish outside the top 10. At the moment, they're giving one of the teammates for Spratt a chance to try and win the stage, Valentina Scandalara, in the break, who, as you mentioned before, has won on this course previously. So they're clearly more focused on a stage victory than the long shot of Spratty winning the series.
That's right. I don't think they're trying to get Spratty to win this series overall mathematically. It's just probably very unlikely to happen, and you don't really want to wish for anything to happen to Ruby Roseman Gannon. I think that Amanda Spratt will still be able to retain her podium position overall. There's no one in this group that is challenging necessarily for the overall series lead or even to bump themselves up into the top five. I think that the bunch is happy enough to let this stage go with some of their riders. As I said, the Bayside Citroën team are happy to back in Matilda Reynolds, and I think Amanda Spratt is more than happy to leave Valentina Scandalara up the road, knowing that she's won on this course before and she is a very quick rider.
There is Scandalara, number 10, swings off from doing her turn of pace down the back straight. Number 33, that is Alicia Wells. She sits in 10th position in the series. She's on 5 points. Tilly Field, or Tilly on a bike, as she refers to herself on Instagram, she sits in 9th position in the overall standings on 6 points. And Matilda Reynolds, she's in 11th position on 3 points. She's been super aggressive throughout the series, riding in support of her teammates. They're working really well together. And Gracie, the gap just keeps on growing. They've been racing now for some 18 and a half minutes. The race is 50 minutes plus three laps. And they're more than a half a lap up on the peloton. This is getting dangerous for the main field.
Are we going to see a catch, being the main peloton being lapped by this breakaway group? I think that they might get the wind up them in a few minutes' time. I think they're just having a bit of a relax now. They might be happy to leave this group out, but they don't really want to be caught by them. They might start to wind up that pace again. I'm interested to see the tactics that Rock Salt Liv Schramm might play. I'm not sure if they're going to back in Tilly Field or not to be able to win from this group of four, or whether they do want to reel it back eventually to try and set that sprint up for Chloe Hosking.
Well, the challenge within the peloton is that the four strongest teams are represented out in front. So who does the chasing? There's not many left.
You're right. There's not many left. I think Team Bridge Lane might have to have some of that responsibility. But as I said, the ARA Skip Capital team actually don't include that rider out in front, the Alicia Wells. So they might also think, well, maybe we need to also bring it back too. That's when things can get a little bit complicated when you have multiple riders on teams that aren't in the official teams out on the road there collecting points.
And getting desperately close to lapping the field. The C5X Citroën is closing in on the rear end of the peloton. There's the lead car just behind the main peloton. And the main peloton, they are cruising down the finishing straight. We are on for this break of four, lapping the main peloton.
This has happened a lot quicker than I thought it would. They are going at a really good pace and the peloton is really just cruising around. But I could see Georgia Baker chatting to her team leader, Ruby Roseman-Gannon. I'd say that they're having a conversation about what they should do. So you could see some of the Bayside Citroën riders maybe get on the front, not to drag this group back, but just to keep a bit more distance between them.
Well, the normal scenario would be if they do lap the peloton, which it looks like they will, the peloton doesn't get withdrawn from the race. The peloton will then sprint for fourth position, unless they manage to drop those four riders and get the lap back, will then be in a position where they sprint for fifth position on the stage when the breakaway is coming down to get three laps to go. And it will create all sorts of confusion in the main field.
It's almost like watching a Madison now, isn't it? Although they're not swinging each other around, but it doesn't look like this peloton is motivated at all to do anything. So maybe they will just let them pass safely, get out of the way, and then start racing again. And it looks like the riders that are up there in the general classification don't feel threatened by this group. So I think that they're just happy to roll around now and save the legs for nationals coming up.
Well, the lap has almost been taken. I've been spotting Commissaire Karen O'Callaghan. She's been marching from one side of the track to the other side of the track. She's the one who has the responsibility of making the big decision on what happens with the peloton when this breakaway group of four does take the lap, and they will take the lap because they continue to close it down. And the gap now is just on around about 20 metres. Tilly Field is flying through the corner.
If I was a sprinter in this peloton, I'd be getting pretty frustrated and disappointed, even if you had a rider in your own team up there. As a sprinter, you're hungry for those kind of opportunities to practice your craft, and I can imagine Chloe Hosking getting a bit itchy in the bunch there. But we just saw the pace lift. They're stringing it out again. This group of four have nearly caught up to the peloton, but not quite. Are we going to see this gap go out again?
I'm not so sure this is going to be really interesting because the gaps now are starting to open up within the peloton, and that can be a chance for the breakaway group to latch onto some of them, but then that causes traffic and chaos for them to try and get around. The lap has not been confirmed. Danny DeFrancesco in the green jersey trying to pick up the pace and make sure that the peloton does not get lapped. But we can see those gaps now starting to emerge.
Yeah, there's some riders here that have been caught napping, and the gaps have been created very quickly by this quick upturn of pace. They were just not expecting that pace to lift, and they've just been dropped out some of these corners.
Good to see the yellow jersey, Ruby Roseman-Gannon, towards the front. Likewise, second place in the overall classification, Amanda Spratt. A few victims at the back, courtesy of the speed that has been applied at the front. There goes the four breakaway riders. They're catching the dropped riders from the peloton, but they need to get all the way through to the front and close it down to those amongst the yellow and the green jersey contenders. And it's Danny DeFrancesco, Gracie, who is the one who's doing all the work at the front. She does not want to be lapped.
No, she's very motivated. She is one of the more motivated riders in this peloton now. Everyone wants to let her be the pacemaker. These riders that have been caught out the back, they're trying to make their way back to the group. The pace is dropping a little again. Everyone's looking around at each other. No one really wants to then be the next instigator of the work.
Danny DeFrancesco looking a little frustrated, understandably so, as she takes a look across the shoulder to see if anybody is prepared to work with her. Small gap, remnants of the peloton, the breakaway group of four, the next through the corner. There they are, Tilly Field, Matilda Reynolds, Alicia Wells and Valentina Scandalara.
This is where it can be a bit frustrating and confusing for the race officials to try and keep track of these four that are going to be passing some riders, but not all of them, because the front of the peloton haven't quite let up yet. I'm not sure when they're going to be passed by this group of four in the breakaway, or if they're going to have another surge of speed before they catch them.
It does make life tough for the race commissaires. and make the confirmation once it's considered that the entire race has been lapped by the breakaway. They've caught the rear end of the peloton and they're making their way towards the front. But there's still a few gaps for them that they need to close down to absolutely lock in that lap having been taken. And the 4 litres have got themselves mixed up amongst a few riders who have been dropped. When we see Alicia Wells, you spoke about her not officially being part of the team for ARA Skip Capital in this race when it comes certainly to the team's classification, but she's very much a part of that team. She's a big part of their season for 2023, and they'll be pretty happy to try and help her and give her some support as this lap does get taken by the breakaway.
That's right. She's been a fantastic young developing rider for them so far. The ARA Skip Capital is one of the great homes in Australia for the under 23 development in both men's and women's. And they've been able to take some of their riders over to Europe last year to give them some experience. Now we can see some movement happening. Looks like another ARA Skip Capital rider trying to make their way to the front. And Danny DeFrancesco is pace setting once again in that green jersey.
And Matilda Reynolds is in the middle of the peloton. You can see her in the white jersey, the white bike. Distinctive style of the Melbourne to Warrnambool winner, Matilda Reynolds, along with her breakaway companions of Alicia Wells, Tilly Field, and Valentina Scandalaro, they have lapped the peloton. So if it stays in this scenario and nobody from the peloton gets a lap themselves on the rest of the race, the peloton will sprint for fifth place when we get to the end of the 50 minutes, and then it will be 3 laps to go for the breakaway to do battle for the stage victory.
Now, the tough thing is that they don't have race radios, so the officials are doing their best to call that information to the riders. Some of the riders in the peloton might not be aware of some of these rules when a situation like this occurs, when a group of riders has lapped the field and then they've mixed themselves up in within that field. So it's going to be, I hope that they're getting the message quite clearly from the officials and from other race directors on the side of the road.
And the other thing to factor in is the race for the green jersey, the battle for the Mitchelton Wines points classification. Now that that lap has been taken, when they get the whistle for the intermediate sprint, everybody within the peloton is eligible to sprint for those points, not just the four riders from the breakaway, like we see when a lap gets taken in a points race or a Madison on the track.
This is definitely becoming more of a track race, isn't it, Matt, than a road race? But I think that it can be some riders might find this situation confusing because they've not been in this kind of situation before. But riders like Chloe Hosking, they're straight on the wheel of Ruby Rosemann-Gunn, and they're still taking this race pretty seriously.
Look at the Rock Salt team. Now, number 19, that's Tilly Field. She's the rider from that team who has been part of the group of four to lap the field. She's now sitting safely in second position. She's behind the very experienced Chloe Hosking. Now, they'll be putting all the eggs, obviously, into the Tilly Field basket and trying to nurse her through the next 20-plus minutes of racing without any trouble and setting her up for a potential stage win.
Yeah, that's a really great tactic from Rockshult Liv Schramm to look after their rider in Tilly Field now and not go for the sprints like we thought they might be with Chloe Hosking and Peter Mullen. So it's good to see someone like Chloe Hosking, who's really so used to that team leader role, who always gets ridden for and protected, to pivot so quickly within a race and then to ride for someone else, ride in the wind. She's showing her class as a bike rider and all of those years of experience.
The yellow jersey up the inside, Ruby Rosemann-Gunn heading towards the second of the intermediate sprints where everybody within the peloton will be eligible to get the points. That looks like Karen on the right in the blue with the whistle poised, just about ready to go. I'm sure I saw her blow the whistle for the intermediate sprint. Ruby Rosemann-Gunn, she wants to take home all the prizes in the yellow jersey. She's equal first place with the green of Danny DeFrancesco.
Danny DeFrancesco is just caught out of position, but she's got an opportunity on this back straight to move herself back up again, try and get back in towards the wheel of Ruby Rosemann-Gunn to try and find her comfortable spot in this peloton before those last two corners, going into the home straight to pick up the points.
So this is the sprint lap, the second last sprint opportunity, the green jersey of Danny DeFrancesco. She needs to get across the finish line ahead of the yellow jersey of Ruby Rose Benganon. But Ruby's got herself in the right spot through that final corner in first position. A look across the shoulder. The green jersey of Di Francesco is sweeping around the outside. The Queenslander has pounced. She's collected 3 points and she gets a little golf clap from Gracie Elvin. Nice ride, Danny Di Francesco.
I did really like that. Well done to Danny. That was a really patient move. She made her way up on the outside on this back straight on that last lap there, putting herself in better position. Ruby Rose Benganon was on the front, maybe a bit too confident, and she just was overcome with a good momentum coming from the back from Danny and just wasn't able to overcome her going into that sprint. So it is nice to see someone else taking home another jersey. So it's good to see that Danny is still trying to put herself in the mix to take home the green jersey today.
The order they are now is how they went across the finish line then. Danny Di Francesco, Peter Mullins, Ruby Rose Benganon. So it's a 2-point advantage for Di Francesco with one intermediate sprint to come. It's 3 points for the win, so it's not sewn up yet.
It is not sewn up yet. So that's what we like to see, the race within the race too. And now there's probably a few races within this race with the breakaway of four having lapped the field, now mixing themselves within this peloton. And then the race for that green jersey, it's not sewn up yet, as you said, Matt. So I think we're going to see one more good sprint to come before the finish.
In 1995 in the Bay Crits, there was a stage that was held in Geelong, a little bit further towards the centre of town from where they are now. There was a breakaway group with around about six riders or so. Patrick Yonker was amongst them, Jay Sweet, I think Rick McCaig, maybe even Neil Stevens, and they lapped the field. As they were just lapping the field, a young mountain biker took off who was still in the under-19 category, and Cadell Evans lapped the field on his own. We could see somebody launch out of this peloton and lap the field and get themselves back into contention.
We could. There's some good time trialers in this field, that's for sure. Cadell Evans had one of the most exceptional engines to come out of Australian cycling, so that's not a surprising story to hear that. I'm sure it would have been surprising back then, though, when he was much lesser known. So will we see a lesser known rider popping out of the front of this bunch? Not so sure. It's quite a small field. Everyone seems to be relatively content with the current situation at the moment.
As Luke Platt was just popping over the barricades to get into the centre to where his team is set up, as he'll be getting ready to race in the men's event, which comes directly after this, where he'll be hoping to support current second place, the winner of the first stage, Brenton Jones, to close the 4-point gap that he has as a deficit to the current leader, Graham Frizzley, who won yesterday.
It looks to me like Lizzie Stannard was putting the pressure on the front of that bunch a little bit. Maybe the Bayside Citroën team aren't that content with the situation at the moment. I think they do want to back in Matilda Reynolds to take out this stage once that comes down to those final few laps when the group of four gets their chance to race against each other again. But they wouldn't mind another aggressive style of racing purely just from a training point of view by the look of it.
Oh, making it hard would work into the favour of Matilda Reynolds. She's got her teammate, Lizzie Stannard, on the front. They've been racing now for 32 minutes of the 50. The peloton, they will finish after 50 minutes of racing. And then the breakaway group of four who lapped the field, Matilda Reynolds, Valentina Scandalara, Tilly Field and Alicia Wells, will get 3 laps to go and they can race amongst themselves. But for the Bayside Citroën team, the tougher the race is, the better it is for Matilda.
You're right there, Matt. She did mention that yesterday in the pre-race interview that they were hoping for a hard race because that plays into their advantage, and today is no different. The Bayside Citroën team do want a difficult race. They want to get rid of some of those riders from the back. They want to make it hard for some of their rivals. Ultimately, a harder race is a safer race. If you're fitter, you can maintain that position up at the front as well. So overall, it's a much better thing for them to do tactically is to keep the pressure on, keep that pace high. And Matilda Reynolds there on the right-hand side of your screen is just moving herself up into a safer position as well to be close to her teammate in Lizzie Stannard on that bright yellow bike.
Reynolds slots into second position. Does she know? Peter Mullins takes over that spot. Peter Mullins, despite the fact that she sits just outside the top three placings for now, she's mathematically equal third, but on a countback, she sits in fifth position. She looks hell-bent on working to get Tilly Field the win, which is understandable. Tilly from her team has lapped the field, and Peter Mullins is the boss of that team. She's the one calling the shots, and she loves to see others on the squad win. There's Mullins, followed by Chloe Hosking. Tilly Field, in fact, it is, that is just in front of Chloe Hosking. Mullins is a little bit further forward. She sits in second position. So she's marshalling the troops of Rock Salt up towards the front. And Spratty and Valentina Scandalara having a good conversation in the middle of the peloton.
They are. They're probably having a bit of a joke about something, no doubt. They've raced with each other and against each other plenty over the years. You can tell as well that they look pretty similar on the bike, and they're even in light blue colours, which is also funny to me. But I would love to know what they're talking about out there today. I'd say that Amanda Spratt and Valet are trying to discuss what their tactic needs to be, because Valentina Scandalara was also in that breakaway four. She needs to make sure that she's up the front, not wasting too much energy. We're saying on this course that it's important to be closer to the front than not, because of all of these tight corners that you have to jump out of continually lap after lap. So Valet needs to also make sure that she's in good position. Spratty is one of the most skilled Australian riders after, I can't remember how many years of racing, probably 20 years of racing now at this high level, and she's going to be a really good pilot there for her teammate in Valet.
Well, she represented Australia at Junior World Championships in BMX. Seriously, Junior, before her 10th birthday, for memory, that she first represented Australia at the Junior World Championships in BMX. She's done it on the track, she's done it on the road, and she's been a silver medalist at the Road Race World Championship. She's one of our all-time greats. And she's now working in support of Valentina Scandalara. But at this point of the race, Gracie, what can Spratty do for her teammate Scandalara?
As I said, she's going to be piloting Valentina Scandalara as much as she can. So she's going to be making sure that Valet's protected. She's not always riding in front of her like she is right now. You can see just on the right of screen that she's bringing Valentina up into a better position. Sometimes as a right-hand man, you're kind of also riding behind a rider as well, making sure that if they do get gapped or they do get put out of position, you've always got eyes on them. So it's just finding that balance between keeping them out of the wind, bringing them up, but also sitting behind them so you can see what's going on and what they might need. So it's about anticipating as much as it is about support.
You can see the bodyguard role that Spratty is playing, taking a look across either shoulder, making sure Scandalara gets through that corner safely, and trying to keep her following the yellow jersey. There's also the opportunity for Spratty to share so much of her experience. Even though Scandalara has won here before, it's nice to have that sounding board. Here's what I'm thinking. My strategy can be to win the stage. What do you reckon, Amanda?
That's right. And Amanda Spratt is very veteran, not just at doing well at bike racing, but being a team captain in bike racing. So part of that role is good communication. It's easy to ride hard and try and tactically do something for yourself in a race, but it's a much more difficult skill to be able to then share that and help someone else and use your words in a race when it's the pace is so high like this, your heart rate's high, you can't think as well. So being able to think on your feet and being able to communicate with your teammates is what makes team captain so valuable within teams.
37 minutes of racing down. Now for the yellow jersey, Ruby Rose Manganon, with the four riders having taken a lap, mathematically, she can't be beaten by Amanda Spratt. So she can breathe a sigh of relief at this point, Ruby Rose.
That's right. We thought maybe at the start that she'd be riding really aggressively. Even though she's in the yellow jersey, it's safer to be out in front, and she's so fit at the moment that she looked like she was going to try and ride away from the field, but now she's looking a bit more relaxed. She's still making sure she's in really good position in the bunch, more for a safety reason, to just make sure that if she gets caught behind any crashes, that risk is minimized. She's having a chat there to her teammate Matilda Reynolds, just making sure Matilda's okay. Matilda's doing a really great job too to stay around Ruby Rose Manganon. Ruby's still a protected rider, even though they're going for the sprint now for Matilda Reynolds.
It looks like there might be a mechanical problem for the green jersey. Danny DeFrancesco, she sits up from within the comfort of the peloton. She's been one of the strongest riders in the race, looking for the pit crew. If she does have a puncher, she is allowed a lap out to rejoin the race in the same position in which she left off. The pits are down the back straight, but also just needs verification from one of the race officials to say, yeah, that is a genuine mechanical problem.
I'm sure that if it is a genuine mechanical problem, they'll let her take a lap out there. Usually it's a flat tyre or some kind of break in your derailleur system or anything to do with your gears. But every now and again, the commissaires aren't very lenient, so we'll see what happens there. It is tough to jump back into the race after taking a lap out, though. It's amazing how quickly your leg seizes up after a tough 30 minutes of racing.
Yeah, at this point, for the way that Danny DeFrancesco has been riding, it's actually a disadvantage as opposed to an advantage to have a lap or two out. a loss of momentum, just lose your rhythm ever so slightly within the peloton. Lizzie Stannard still leading, working for two of her teammates now. Matilda Reynolds in the white colours on the white bike, who was part of the group of four to have lapped the rest of the field, and also securing the yellow jersey for Ruby Roseman-Gannon for the second year running. Hasn't Ruby Roseman-Gannon marked herself as a favourite to go back-to-back in the Criterium on Friday up in Sturt Street, Ballarat, but also Sunday she's a big chance in the road race?
Oh, for sure. She is a favourite for the Crit Nationals on Friday. She's definitely going to be the number one to beat, but she was fourth last year in the road race, which tells us that she is an all-rounder. She's not just a sprint rider. She can climb as well. And I think she's only stronger 1 year later after a whole season of professional racing under her belt. She got to do some of the top races in the Women's World Tour last year, and that just adds so many layers to your overall strength and character as a bike rider, and confidence too.
And she's also spent a little bit of time in Ballarat just before Christmas with Luke Plapp, and they got a bit of a lesson on how to do some latte art. I've got to tell you, Luke Plapp can do some seriously good latte art. Ruby Roseman-Gannon wasn't bad either.
Coffee is a big part of cycling, that's for sure. If you're a cyclist, I don't need to explain it, but for those that are new to the sport, the coffee shop stop is a must. Unfortunately, it does upset everyone else in the cafe, but a lot of riders also have their own coffee machines at home, including myself, so you do get quite good at the latte art. I'm not going to claim that I'm a professional, so I was impressed with what they could do.
There's Danny DeFrancesco in the green colours, so she's just about to rejoin the race. She's had her lap sometime on the course this short, just 650 metres. She'll be entitled to get two laps out with a genuine mechanical problem and rejoin the race. There she is, the winner of the National Road Series from 2022 and the leader of the Mitchelton Wines points classification here at the Bay Crits. Settles smartly back into the front. She makes sure she doesn't drift too far back. She's ridden really well as an independent in this race. She's got no teammates.
That was a really good example of how to get back in after taking a lap out, just bringing up the speed as you can feel that bunch behind you, having a quick look around and then just jumping straight back in and not waiting for them to pass you, because you don't want them to let them go and have to chase back on or to be right at the back and have to work your way forward. So she just slipped right back into the front there, and she didn't seem too fazed at all by taking that lap out.
And her time in getting back in has been good. She'd be grateful that it wasn't a little later, that mechanical problem, because we're not too far away from the final whistle in the race for the intermediate sprint prizes. They've been racing now for 42 minutes. It's a 50-minute race plus three laps for the four riders who have lapped the field. The rest of them will be sprinting for the minor placings for 5th down to 10th place when they get to the end of that 50 minutes. It will create a bit of confusion within the peloton, but those that have lapped the field, they know exactly where they need to be. Follow the others that they took the lap with. And then when the sprint happens, the other four got to keep going, and those that have sprinted somehow got to try and clear the track and make sure that it's safe for the others.
It is going to be a little bit confusing and a bit chaotic. So hopefully they've been given some good information as to how to do it best. But it's tough when you're just racing by all the officials and all the race directors. They can't exactly communicate as effectively as if they had race radios. But I think they'll figure it out, Matt. And then they've got three laps to really figure it out as well. So it's going to be an exciting finish nonetheless.
And the four riders who have lapped the field, none of them are real noted sprinters. They're all reasonably quick. They've all managed to show themselves inside the top 10 on a few occasions within this race as the sprint is on. And it's Danny DeFrancesco ahead of Ruby Roseman-Gannon. Chloe Hosking in third position. DeFrancesco takes a look across the shoulder.
Ruby did not seem too fazed by that sprint. She was more just keeping herself in good position, staying out of trouble, making sure that if there was any breakaways going that she wanted to be in there, even though the breakaway of four that have caught the bunch are in it to win it today, you still want to be still racing the race. It's a good opportunity to practice your racecraft, your skills, and to stay out of the crashes as well, staying up out of trouble.
And Danny DeFrancesco, she was one of Australia's elite triathletes for a long time. She's done away with the run and the swim, and she's now becoming one of our elite cyclists. And now as we're getting down towards the business end, they've been racing for almost 45 minutes. They're trying to get themselves organised in the sprint for the minor placings amongst those who were part of the peloton and didn't take the lap.
it's still a good thing to be in the top 10 on a results sheet. So there's plenty of riders here that haven't given up completely. They're still trying to get that training in the legs. You want to get some points at the end of this race so you can maintain your position in the top 5 or the top 10. It's a good opportunity to practice your sprint as well. So often in a road race, you would see if there was a breakaway that had won, the bunch still sprints for those results. They want to get those UCI result points, but they also need the bunch sprint practice. There's no better practice as a sprinter than to be in a bunch situation and sprint. So Chloe Hosking here is definitely going to use this as an opportunity to keep working on what she is best at. And I'm sure a handful of other riders also want to make sure that they use this opportunity, even if it's not for the win today.
ARA Pro Racing Sunshine Coastal. That's the old name. It's now ARA Skip Capital. A few riders moving around the outside. They've got one rider that's not officially part of the team for this series, Alicia Wells, who has been part of the group to take the lap. So the yellow jersey, Ruby Roseman Gannon, she has got that yellow jersey well and truly secured. The green jersey, Danny DeFrancesco, they'll be sprinting for fifth position when they get down to the end of the 50 minutes of racing.
Amanda Spratt there in those light blue and white colours on the right, just slipping in behind Georgia Baker and Chloe Hosking. Amanda Spratt was teammates with plenty of those bike exchange riders for many years, but Spratty has made the move after 11 whole years with the Green Edge family to go across to Trek Segafredo. And she's certainly starting the summer with a bang. She's in great form. She's had a couple of years of bad luck with some injuries and a particularly bad injury that she had to come back from, the iliac artery endofibrosis, which many cyclists suffer from. The arteries in your hips get a bit blocked up and you have to get them surgically fixed, and it takes a long time to recover from that. It is quite a dangerous surgery as well. There's a lot of risk that comes with that, and there's also a risk that comes with the recovery as well. So she's done a really good job over the last 18 months to get over that, to work her way mentally and physically through that recovery. She raced quite well last year but had a few things that just didn't quite go to plan for her, unfortunately. Crashing out of the Tour de France Femme was also a difficult thing that she had to overcome, but I think she's got so much fire in her belly, so much left to give. I think she's really excited to start this year with a new team. And she's certainly showing us that she's got some more sprinter legs than she's ever had for a long time. So combining that with her great climbing ability, she is going to be one of the favourites going into this weekend's national championships as well, having won it 3 times already.
And they're down to 2 laps to go for the rest of the peloton. An update for you in the race for the green jersey. Danny DeFrancesco was deemed ineligible for the intermediate sprints because of the laps taken out with the mechanical problem. So Ruby Roseman Gannon, she got across the finish line first and now moves into the lead in the battle for the green jersey. So she wins the green jersey classification by 1 point. She's got 1 lap to go to sew up the yellow jersey. She wants to close it out with another strong sprint finish. ARA Pro Racing Sunshine Coast moving towards the front. Amanda Spratt up the inside. She goes underneath the green jersey of Danny DeFrancesco. And now we see Ruby in yellow, followed by Georgia Baker. Then it's Chloe Hosking. There's a shuffling of positions down the back straight.
This back straight is the best opportunity to try and improve your position. It's a bit of a sprint all the way out of that corner, all the way up to the next corner. The pace is being set super high by Ruby Roseman Gannon. She's got Georgia Baker on her wheel in that white jersey. It looks like Peter Mullins coming up on the inside.
Mullins sticks it up the inside. She uses all of her experience. It's not just about horsepower on this course. Mullins has got bike handling skills. Georgia Baker, though, is getting over the top. Spratt is in the mix. It's Georgia Baker who wins the sprint for fifth position. Now the breakaway group of four, they've got the course to themselves once again. Have there been any split scores between them that could result in one of them going on the attack?
It does look like it. Looks like Matilda Reynolds is going on the attack now. I can just see her going through that corner much faster than many of the other riders that are sitting up from that sprint. I'm not sure how many of her... Oh, it looks like that group of four have come together. They're looking at each other now, and they've got three laps to play cat and mouse. I'm really excited to see how this is going to play out.
Scandalar at the front. Tilly Field in second position. Alicia Wells, it is now at the back of the group in the white colours. It is Matilda Reynolds. Cat and mouse is underway.
This win would mean a lot to Matilda Reynolds. She's also without a contract for this year, so she is really hoping to get across back to Europe. She got to race in 2022 and got a lot of great experience in the European racing scene, but she does not have a contract for this year, so any results in the summer of cycling are really going to help her to try and secure another contract to go either race in Europe or in America.
And they're down to two laps to go, and they're riding this like a four-up sprint derby on the velodrome. This is a big tactical affair. Wells at the front. Tilly Field looks across to Scandalara. Scandalara, she's won here before. She's got the experience. That will give her confidence.
Having experience is really important in this type of situation. You see riders that don't have much experience get quite nervous, and they're usually the ones that get stuck on the front or start making the pace higher, and they get stuck there for much longer than they'd like to be. You can see riders like Valentina Scandalara, she is making sure she's hugging one side of the road for most of the time, so riders can only pass on one side. You don't want to be sitting in the middle of the road in this kind of situation because you're not sure what side you're going to be attacked on. So it's important to just stick to one side, just look over one shoulder and keep an eye on those riders behind you and not be in that front position.
And from this final corner, this is the second last time around the corner. If you've got the lead position through this corner, slowly drift your way across to the left-hand barrier. That's the straightest run home to the finish and forces the others to go the long way around. Just bend ever so slightly to the left. Alicia Wells finds herself stuck on the front, followed by Scandalara. Tilly Field is in third spot. Matilda Reynolds at the back. She's on a slightly bigger gear as she's about to launch an attack.
I wouldn't be surprised if Matilda Reynolds tries to launch an attack here. I think she needs to be patient, though, and just wait for the sprint back herself
track
in.
Track stand still just about here, Gracie.
They are going really slow. I've never seen riders go this slow on the Ritchie Boulevard circuit. It's usually a smash fest, but this is a really great situation. Certainly not the race that we were expecting, but it's great entertainment, isn't it, Matt?
Oh, the bell sounds. 650 metres to go. Who wins the final stage at the 2023 Citroën Bay Crits? Scandalara in the light blue colours of Novotel Prestige Jayco. Behind her, Tilly Field from Roxalt. Then it's Matilda Reynolds in the white colours. At the back from ARA Skip Capital is Alicia Wells. Matilda giving a little bit of distance. The pace, surely it will pick up in a scurry for positions in that last corner. Matilda wants the element of surprise. She wants to get to the back. Alicia doesn't let her.
No, this is great racing by the young rider Alicia Wells, showing that she's got the confidence to ride with some more experienced riders here. Valentina Scandalara has found herself on the front. You don't really know what she's got in the tank. She can be really quick sometimes, but you don't really want to be racing from the front. But because of the final corners being so fast and tight, you can hold it all the way to the finish if you can find that speed and you can carry that speed. And Valet may or may not have that. I'm thinking Matilda Reynolds is going to launch into this final corner and try and hold that to the finish line.
And going this slow, they'll be able to hear all the free advice they're getting from the side of the road. Scandalara at the front starts to pick up the pace ever so slightly. Matilda Reynolds, she's the first to break ranks. Scandalara responds and she's fighting for the inside with Tilly Field. Field gets through in second. It's Reynolds with a slight lead. Wells trying to come from behind. Scandalara looking to win on Ritchie Boulevard again. It is Reynolds who's gone first and gets to the finish line. It'll be a photo. Matilda makes it. She gets the win. Scandalara in second. I think we'll wait to see how that goes with the battle with Tilly Field. Fourth place is Alicia Wells. What a stage.
That was a very exciting finish. I really did think that Matilda Reynolds was going to go for that final corner and have that confidence that she could hold that speed all the way to the finish line. But it is quite a long home straight from that final corner. You need to carry that momentum, but you need to be strong enough to hold that long sprint. Valentina Scandalara almost got it on the line. It did look like a photo finish to me, but Matilda Reynolds is pretty confident that she got the win. It certainly looked like it on the camera shot. You can see Pat Shaw there, team leader, for Team Bridge Lane, giving her big congratulations. I think he's also her coach well, so he's going to be very happy about that today.
And then in the race for positions inside the top three, Matilda Reynolds is pretty happy. She'll now move to 15 points, which depending on where Spratt, Hosking and Baker finished in that sprint finish for the minor placings, she could be moving up to fourth or fifth position in the overall standings. Get the calculator out, Gracie. We're going to have to wait to see exactly where the placings were amongst the others as well. A huge win by Matilda Reynolds. The presentations will be coming a little bit later on for the overall winner, though, and that will be the yellow jersey on Ruby Rose Van Gannon. I think it was Scandalara in second. What are your thoughts?
I do think it was Valet in second there, but, man, it was a close sprint between those three. I think Matilda Reynolds did a very good job in staying patient in those last three laps. I think in the past, her nerves might have got the better of her. She would have attacked earlier, but she waited until that last moment to get that good position going into the final corner, and she had the strength to carry it all the way to the finish. She did leave the door open a little bit for Valet to come through on the inside. You were saying it is a shorter line there on the left, so that's why Valet could make up those meters so quickly going into the finish line. But Tilly Fielded also did a really great ride today. It was a very close finish, blanket finish over those three riders. And Alicia Wells in fourth, she should still be very proud of her ride as well. She was also showing maturity in the way she was handling that situation.
A really classy performance by Alicia Wells. A lot to like about her bright future. Confirmation, it was Matilda Reynolds with the stage victory. Valentina Scandalara in second. Tilly Field in third position. Alicia Wells in fourth. It was Georgia Baker who won the sprint finish for fifth position. Ruby Rose Van Gannon goes out the winner of the series on 25 points. Her teammate Georgia Baker in second position on 18 points. Chloe Hosking gets on the podium in third on 17, Matilda followed Reynolds. By Amanda Spratt
what
in fourth. Then
that was,
Matilda
that
Reynolds.
That was about as Macca. Exciting as it gets.
I know. I was so scared. It feels nervous to me. I just want to firstly just thank my team and Ruby. Like, I went up to her and I wanted to do a flyer because I didn't back my sprint. And honestly, I've had more seconds than dinners in racing. And anyone that knows me and has raced with me knows how close I've come so many times. And I was close yesterday, but I'd burnt too many matches. And Ruby just said, back yourself. And I looked at Pat Shaw, my coach on the sidelines, and he was giving me a bit of advice as well. And I was just looking at my team for advice because I was so fortunate this period for Bay Crits. Usually I'm racing against Ruby and Georgia, and it was a great experience to race with them this year for this series. And I just cannot tell you how relieved I am. I haven't signed with the team yet this year, and I just had to back myself and go with my gut that if I had the performances, I could hopefully sign with someone worthwhile that I think I'm worthy of. And to get the win is huge here now.
It is huge. Take us through that last lap, because you got the likes of Valentina Scandalara, former winner of the series and probably one of the most experienced riders in this peloton. And not to mention the other two, of course, Tilly Field, Alicia Wells. What was going through your head in this last lap? Because it was snail's pace.
It was honestly probably the single worst situation I could be in. Again, as I said, I wanted to do a fly. I knew I had the fitness to go long. I definitely didn't have the snap. And as I said, I just had to back myself, like Rube said. And I took it on a really light gear through the corner, just made sure I held it up. And I've just kept thinking they were coming at me. They weren't coming. And I just, all I could do, and I had my team on the sideline screaming, and I just, oh, thank gosh, it would have eaten me up for days, and now I'm okay, so I'm okay. Cancel the counsellor, I'm going to be fine.
You're fine, well done, and I'll bring Ruby in now. Ruby, the younger one giving advice to the older one, how does that work?
I think sometimes, like, you've got the pressure on your shoulders, and you just need someone to, you know, back yourself. And you know, I know Matilda very well. Last year in the last stage of this, we were in a break together sprinting against each other, and I know how good she is. She's such a talented rider, so strong and so fast. So I backed her all the way and she pulled it off, and it was an amazing day.
Great day, and of course you win the series. So it was, we knew before mathematically you could be beaten, so you had to stay focused, stay switched on. What was it like for you in that peloton today?
Oh yeah, pretty good. We had some fun out there. I think we raced pretty aggressive at the start, which is sort of what split up the bunch a bit and like allowed a move to go. We wanted to like make it exciting. So yeah, it was really good, and Matilda got away, and then the bunch slowed down to nothing and we thought we were going to get pulled for a bit. So yeah, but a great day out there, and yeah. amazing race.
It was an amazing race. I'll let you both go and enjoy it. Well done.
Thanks so much.
No, good job.
Love that sharing of the victory between the two of them. The overall win going to the yellow jersey with Ruby Rose Manganon. And Matilda Reynolds, she's worth a risk for a team that has got one spot left on their roster, surely, Gracie.
Definitely. There are some teams that are still scooping up a few riders that from other teams that have folded or riders that don't have contracts. So I've got my fingers crossed for her that she gets a ride this year. She's certainly a talented rider. She's a bit older than some of the other riders that you see trying to get over to Europe, but that shouldn't be a detractor. That shouldn't be something a team looks at. If someone's got talent, they've got talent. And Annevink van Vleuten is a great example of you can be bloody good at any age. So I really hope that Matilda gets a great opportunity. She gives good interviews too, doesn't she? She's a character. She's got a good turn of phrase. So I'm really happy for her today.
She gives a great interview. Congratulations, Ruby Rose Manganon, taking out the overall victory in the Citroën Bay Crits. She also takes home the green jersey for the points classification, the Mitchelton Wines points classification, and Citroën, Bayside Citroën, they take out the team's classification. That's all from the 2023 Bay Crits for the Women's Series. We're going to take a short break, and then we'll be back soon with the final stage of the men's race.
Gotta dream about it. Gotta find a way to do the things that make you feel alone. Gotta think about it. Gotta dream about it.
Breathe in, breathe out. Here, you're surrounded by silence. You feel in total harmony with your movement, with the world. Here, you simply feel serene. At peace.
All new Citroën C5X.
The spirited traveler eagerly anticipates the sea of possibilities the new adventures bring. The unwritten paths, unexpected journeys, and unforgettable memories that lay just beyond the horizon. Discover Spirit of Tasmania Key Geelong, where a new adventure begins. Be a spirited traveler.